And welcome back. This is the RPG check. Since we advanced Sagani's quest a little more, I wanted to see if these other two had anything to be done. Now, how do I get into this? Like this.
Farewell.
See ya. Okay, we can level her up. Actually really pretty in this portrait. I'm not going to really use her as a character, so I'm just quickly going through this. Because is she also level 9 at this point? What does that sound? 8th level. Let's see if there's anything to be said to her.
Your mind comes bearing questions, Watcher.
I didn't even click on that yet. I just went over it. Yeah, I had questions for you. Let your mind speak for you. I shall listen past the words. Okay, even for a cipher, you're weird. Because I'm a cipher and, okay. You addressed me as a Watcher when we met. Do you know what a Watcher is? There was a slow chill, and for a moment it seems as if she was going to fade from your vision, as if she can't bear to be seen.
The title came unbidden. I do not know why I spoke of it. Yet it seemed the right mantle, a familiar one.
Yet I do not know where it came from where it came, if I have given offense. Oddly enough, it feels like she's not speaking to you. It feels like she's speaking to an audience. The air takes on a curious edge, a chill, which persists for a short moment, then fades into a dull fear. If I have given offense, forgive me. Forgive me. You would know more than I. Why are you afraid?
I do not know. It is an old feeling. I do not know where it stems from. It was a word that arose when you saw me. It is said watchers see much that others do not, and I have been hidden from the eyes of others for some time.
How is it no one can see you? Is it true that nobody in the group can see her?
Their eyes see me, but their minds will not remember past the call.
Call?
My face is like the call of a newborn, hiding the face beneath. And for my body, I am able to wrap myself as a mother cradling her child. I am here, as you see me. But to them, their eyes see only the cloak that I wear. A peasant mother, dirty, shabby, not worth knowing. As a watcher, you see more than others. To the eyes of most, I am as unseen as the spirits you share memories with.
How are you able to affect minds?
I divert the flow of their senses down a different path, to a place easily forgotten. It is not unwelcome when one does not desire the presence of others. The surface of their minds register a figure, but the memory slips away. They see a woman, but there is no desire for conversation, no desire for any questions, and I have none to ask.
When we first met, how was I able to enter your dream?
I do not know. What do you speak of? If you were in my thoughts, I could not feel your presence, nor do I know what you saw there.
As she speaks, you suddenly feel an odd sensation in your mind, as if walking in her thoughts would be as if walking down a back street of merchant stalls. The claustrophobia of wooden shelves and canvas tarps, made less oppressive by the sheer number of enticing vials and bottles that stretch out to the sides of you. You suddenly realize that whether she permits it or not, you could enter her dream and observe it without her ever knowing. And in response, your hand twitches. There is the feeling that you could simply pick up a vial, taste it, sample it,
and keep the memory as your own. Well, she's like a spirit or something. She's like not really here. She's passed on already or something. She's part here and part not with us. And suddenly you find yourself back in her, your present thoughts, though you are away but a moment. She seems unaware of your diversion of thought. It may be one of your gifts, an ability to walk in memories as easily as someone walks upon the ground. Perhaps you'd like to hear of what I saw in your memories. A mixture of curiosity and fear wells up between you. She raises her left hand, the chiming at her wrists quelling the rise within her. She is frightened, but curiosity anchors her.
And what did you see in my memories? I would hear you speak of them.
The dream, the memory I saw upon meeting you, it was you helping give birth to a child. There is silence, and as your breath falls still, you hear the faint cry of a child in the distance, a newborn child, almost exactly like what you heard in a dream. As you listen, the grieving mother raises both her hands, as if weaving, her wrists chiming as she does so, in a semblance of the gentle turning she provided while the newborn was crowning. To your surprise, you recognize the motions and the words from the memory, even as they are new to you. As she weaves her hands through the air in front of her, the child's cries grow still, yet the sound of the chimes weaves almost hypnotically into your thoughts. The sky seems sharp and clear, and you feel as if you are towering over your surroundings, as if kneeling atop a great pillar, just as she did in the memory. To your surprise, the grieving mother falls as if her strings were cut, and her knees crack hard against the ground. Ow. Her hands never cease moving in the air, the chimes echoing her movements. In a ragged voice, you hear her speak. The voice is that of a much older woman than the one before you, harsh, almost desperate.
Tell me what you saw. Show me what you saw. Where were you?
Her eyes, now terribly sharp and real, are filmed with white, silver white like Adra.
I don't even remember. I guess it was a mountain ledge, in a forest. Yeah, I'll choose the cipher option. It was in the middle of a forest, atop a great plateau. The sky was clear, mist blanketing the trees. As she kneels before you on the ground, she whispers to you, hoarsely, and even fainter with the distance between you.
The stone of the plateau. Its color. Tell me its color.
I don't remember. This was like so long ago that when we first went into Deerford that we found her. It was a plateau of granite carved into a tower. I'm just guessing. She leans back as if looking back at the sky, but her eyes are closed, the film building on them. With a slow intake of breath, you feel time become quiet around you. I do not feel the memory. I do not know if it is mine, but... Her hair falls across her features again like a veil, and she nods, not with her chin, but with a push in her mind. But thank you for trying. I want to talk about the birth memory again, help you recall it.
Tell me what you saw. Show me what you saw. The stone of the plateau. Its color. Tell me its color.
Okay, it was silver Adra, its surface warmed by the sun. I guess that was it. As you watch, her hands rise before her. She clasps them, then cups them, as if feeling them for the first time. And she stares down into the cradle of her hands, and the chimes sound once, twice, as they swing with the movement.
And what did these hands hold?
Again she speaks, sharp, hoarse. Yes, she was holding these chimes. A newborn child, cipher option. There was a sudden intake of breath, and then a release. Her eyes blur closed, forming into slits, but in the brief glimpse you have of her changing expression, the rippling pain in her features seems to have smoothed. She swallows once, twice. Three times, and ain't it? No, and then you feel her once again in your thoughts, the rasping husk of her voice swallowed and drawn within her.
It was the birthing bell you saw. Has it been so long? Have I forgotten so much?
There is surprise, followed by a rising horror swirling beneath the words. With the words comes a river of impulses, thoughts, as if loosed from a breaking dam, and as your mind wraps the impulses into words, you realize it is her muscles and her hardened thoughts relaxing and breathing again. There is such an intensity you almost want to step back from the flow, but you find the wave of impulses causes questions to float to the surface. Among them is a name, Watcher. What is the birthing bell?
It is a plateau formed of the spirit stone Audra. At its top is set a great bell, cradled in the reaching arm of the plateau. It stirs in the wind, and it sounds for leagues when struck by kith hands. In distant times, the great bell served as a Glamfellen watchtower, perhaps. Why they abandoned it, I do not know. Other men came in time, settlers, and claimed the tower as their own. I, in turn, claimed it from them. The pillar became a cradle where I could draw new souls into the world.
Where is the birthing bell located? The birthing bell lies deep in the great forest of the Deerwood, at the borders of Glamfellen lands. Surrounding it, barely a town, not one you would find on any map, but held an important place for those there, even if we were far from the beaten track. Small families, tied like a knot, joined at the wrists in mind, in thought. All were welcomed. All had purpose. In your memory, were you helping a woman give birth?
Yes. Yet, I believe you only saw a small part of the birthing ritual. It is not all in a moment, nor in a day. It is a journey of many years between the child, the mother, and I.
There was much I could do to aid the mother. Some sought the physical comfort of ritual to steady their thoughts, even Audra from the bell. Others would seek advice, words of counsel for the days ahead. I was able to provide draughts, tinctures, and a reading of the child's spirit, all to strengthen the mother. A telling of the child's spirit?
Many would come seeking their child's future, or a reading into the child's past, the lives its soul is said to have lived.
There was a slow chill, and in a moment it seems as if she was going to fade from your vision, as if she can't bear to be seen, and there is a spike of fear, alarm.
Such things are not mine to see. I meant no offense.
Oddly enough, it feels like she's not speaking to you. It feels like she's speaking to an audience. Again, you feel the word Watcher resounding in her mind. You're frightened. Something about Watchers. As the thought of Watchers crosses your mind, you feel a sharp pain, stabbing, and a sudden burn of lashes across your back and shoulder, and then it is gone, and you feel the grieving mother before you, silent, almost fearful, wary.
I was something else, but because the title Watcher was cast on me, the word carried a weight I had neither earned nor deserved. The world seems filled with such titles. They distract, I think, from the actions of the person, from their strengths.
Why did you believe you were a Watcher?
The world has many corners, and in some corners the name Watcher is more known. It is an easier title than others, and at times it is easier to wear. Placing a title upon what is unknown can dispel the fear of it, and I did not fight it. I even believed it true, though I knew little of the ways of Watchers. It even granted me strength. I was able to see the thoughts of others, shape them, and help guide souls. Watcher seemed enough, and the name seemed to matter little in the light of one's acts.
But if they came to you to read their child's souls, what did you tell them?
I drew upon the present. I felt the soul of the mother before me, and used that to tell the child's path, to give it a voice. If only the thoughts of the mother and the emotions that lie beneath were mine to impart. I did, and so I used that as the telling of their child's future.
What if it turned out to be untrue?
Futures fulfilled by one's own spirit are as strong as anything seen by another's eyes. And if one draws from the emotion of the mother, it matters only when harm is done. And their lives I knew well. I could weave their lives, their thoughts over time, to the mother, to the child. And once the child had been born, was sheltered, I could relax the threads of thought until the child could stand on its own.
So you shaped their thoughts, made their readings true.
This is my calling, to show them the life I see before them, and even greater, make them believe it.
That is not what a watcher does. We do not shape minds, we see them as they are.
Even the most strongly worded tells may not be enough to save a child and allow it to be born. If I have the strength to strip away the stem of a mother's spite to expose kindness, weave nurturing from disdain and neglect, then that is my calling. And with the weight of Watcher behind my thoughts, these tells gain strength. Strength I never possessed on my own. They believed. And what they believed became the truth. With each child that was set upon that path, the title of Watcher became stronger. You must understand, without such weight upon my words, many lives would have been lost, drowned, cast in the lake beyond the bell. Now the trail to the lake is lost and reclaimed by the forest, as was meant. A watcher was not there to look over us, but it was a watcher that saved them, and with a watcher's strength, children were born, were cared for, and grew strong.
To inflict your will on another, though, that is not reading, that is control.
What use is a frightened will when a spirit is at stake? Would you let the fears of a mother end her newborn's life? You felt it in the memory, the weight of it, the importance of the child's life. It was a memory we shared.
That memory, it's not the truth, is it? And suddenly there's a rasping cry across your consciousness. She raises her hands and you see the chimes drape from them, yet they make no sound as she moves.
A greater good was done, and children were saved. It is a choice you may be forced to make one day, and when faced with it, you will make the same one.
When that happens, I'll be making my own choice.
This choice is not yours to make, Watcher. You will do as the world needs, as its children need. It is greater than you and your twist of sight.
I have other questions about the birthing bell. Or I don't. I want to discuss something different. One and three should be grayed out. I wanted to know more about you.
And I you. In asking, we reveal ourselves to each other.
Why are you called the Grieving Mother? The air seems to go still for a moment, and time stretches as it did before when the two of you met. There is a wash of uncertainty from her mind, slowly shaping into questions that swirl and do not coalesce. She does not move. She seems paralyzed, as if you have just wrapped her in a cold blanket.
That is a question for you, not I. That is not my name, although if you wish to hang the title on me, I cannot stop you. Is that what you see when your eyes fall upon me?
So, I named you? As a watcher, you may see what I do not, or your mind shapes the thoughts I project into a new meaning. There is truth in the title, but it is not all I am. So what do you grieve, then? You must have felt it, seen it. It has as many names as the pain it has caused. As the words take shape, they seem to tumble from her, and the wave is great, rushing into your mind. To your surprise, you feel as if you have been touched by the Beowick again, and behind it, cutting through the torrent like a knife, are the thoughts of the grieving mother. There is a wound cut across the belly of the world, a jagged knife that has stripped the stems from men and carved furrows across the wombs of women. There has much I have forgotten, but I can feel the wound all around me. It will not let me rest, not let me be. The children have gone silent, yet their voices may be heard again. Are you speaking of the Hollowborn? The word. There is a slowness of thoughts as if the word is being weighed, accepted. It doesn't feel natural to her. You can sense it. Was once unknown to me, as was much of what unfolded in the outside world. When the curse came upon us, I thought it a smaller thing, a thing of communities and hearths. Her thoughts seemed to stumble as if on weak legs. It was only when I walked did I feel it stretching out around me, in all the cracks of the world. Children have been cursed. I do not think it was something they caused, nor something deserved. That which is inside them has been torn away. I do not know how, but this wound must be stitched closed. The world bleeds forth from between a woman's legs. If this blood is not stemmed, the world will die and grow quiet. Do you know its cause? There is a desperation, a welling fear. You can almost feel her thoughts shivering, and you realize she is as lost as you are on the matter, and then a sudden, sharp clarity. I shall know it through you. Your eyes will track the cause, find the path, and I will be beside you. There is no wound that cannot be healed, and if you are truly a watcher, then this wound may be seen for what it is. You saw me where I hid. Whoever's hands have stifled the world, or stilled the world, sorry, you shall see them too. And what if there is no way to heal it? What then? I will be there, and you will do what must be done. You are given your sight so that you may watch the world, and you will tend it. The children shall have their voice again. If your will is weak, then I shall strengthen it. Lean upon me. You feel a weight in her words, as if her hands are on your shoulders. You feel the questions in your mind lose their edge and become merely words. As I lean upon you, you shall be my eyes, and I shall be your hands when the time comes. Okie doke. What do you think of Deerwood and the Empire? Those titles are markings on a map, and channel people's minds in violent directions. Such things are a threadbare blanket cast over the world where men and women seek more importance than simply being. How do you see the world, then? The world is a field of souls, tilled by Barath's wheel. The thought of cultures and territories do not concern me. The sowing and harvest of the field does. Excuse me, guys. Barath's wheel has slowed, perhaps stopped altogether. Whatever words, titles, laws, and blades not devoted to carving away the harm or healing that wound holds little importance for me. There's something else I would know about you. I want to discuss something different. Okay, that's all. Addendum. Okay. So I met a strange woman whom I know only as the Grieving Mother. She's a powerful cipher who shrouds herself in plain view. Yet even though our minds experience a powerful communion, I know little about her or where she came from. Okay, so she's not a ghost. She just shrouds herself from view. When I first encountered the Grieving Mother on the road, I experienced a dream, or was it a memory, of childbirth. Perhaps the Grieving Mother herself can explain what I saw. She didn't realize what I'd seen inside her mind, nor did she know exactly what this vision was. If I can help her recall the details, perhaps then she'll be able to tell me more. The memory involved a place known as the birthing bell. It was clearly of great significance to the grieving mother. Perhaps she can tell me something of what happened there and why it is important to her. The grieving mother was a midwife at the birthing bell, and she used to read the souls of unborn children. However, she admitted that such readings were often fabricated based on what the expectant mother wanted to hear. She clearly thought she was doing these women and children a service, but she wasn't inclined to discuss the matter further at the moment. Perhaps she'll open up more as our journeys continue. I'm going to be leaving her here, so she'll have to do that some other time. I want to check up on our druid. I guess this is going to be our entire episode. We're already 25 minutes in.
Our paths shall part.
Okay, get to level him up. Athletics. Yeah, athletics. Just took 3 ranks. Level 1 spells can now be used per encounter. Looks a lot different than in his portrait.
Yeah? As a peripatetic loner, I'm not privy to the latest news, but the Hollowborn Children is a tale that has reached even my reclusive ears. Or, rather, ear.
What are your thoughts on the Hollowborn?
Any time a life is separated from its soul. I wanted to pretend it was just a rumor when I first heard of it.
His eye meets yours, and his usual default smile becomes a frown. His voice trails off. He has several starts and stops before finally deciding on how to finish his thought.
In my youth, I'd curse the dear woodens for being ignorant despoilers that breed out of control. But soulless babies? What heartless gods would inflict that kind of tragedy? No parent or child deserves to be a part of that horror.
What do the Glamfellen druids think of this plight?
It's been a long time since I've spoken with my circle. They'd probably tell you what I'd tell you. This plight was most certainly the consequence of someone trespassing into Anguithan places, not meant for folk. I mean, what else other than the gods could inflict punishment of such impressive scale?
Let's talk of other matters.
Need something?
He asks with a raised eyebrow. Tell me about yourself.
My second favorite subject.
He runs his fingers through his scalp, preening his fur.
What would you like to know?
Oh boy, all this. How did you come to be trained as a druid? Hiravias thumbs his half-shredded ear and thinks to himself for several seconds. It wasn't entirely by choice, not the start at least. My ambition was to be a hunter. I merely arrived by a different trail. As a child, an Anamphath came to visit. An honored guest is occasion for a grand chase, but I was left out, instructed instead to be cupbearer to the old wise one, while the rest were on hunt. I'm sure you can guess what happens. Wise Anamphath gives dumb child a shred of attention. We ended up talking until the hunters returned. He gave me... His hands dart across his body, scouring the pockets and folds of his tunic. This. He presents a rusted iron medallion fashioned in the likeness of a hound's head, a common icon among the frontiersmen, explorers, and other seekers faithful to Galloween. The Anamphath insisted I be trained, and none in my village would defy him. Now, he smiles broadly, I don't need a bow to hunt. Where are you from originally?
My mother's crotch. You?
Oh my god. What a coincidence. I also came from your mother's crotch.
For the record, only I'm allowed to insult my mother. But I respect your dedication to banter, so I'll let it slide. This time.
He narrows his one eye at you.
I grew up in Erglonfoth, specifically in and around Thane Bog. My people, the Fisher Crane tribe, are migrant stewards of the land. I've walked the whole of Glanfoth many times.
That's awesome. That's hilarious. What's the story behind the symbol of Whale on your eye patch? Whale is known as the Eyeless Face, so his symbol seemed a good fit for my eye patch. He absentmindedly rubs his finger along the strap of the patch band. Whale iconography is rather popular in my home tribe, but it seems he is not as widely venerated here in the Deerwood. I remember thinking that if I consecrated my eye to he who obfuscates and reveals, then maybe with enough devotion, Whale would make use of the old ruined thing. He pulls on the eye patch strap and lets it go with a loud snap. So if you think you see me staring at rumps and cleavage, it's really just the will of Whale controlling my gaze. Honest. What's your relationship with Galloween? I was raised as a disciple of the Seeker God. He is the champion of the hunt, be it the simple struggle for sustenance or the scholarly pursuit of knowledge. In my older years, I've found... He cuts himself off, shakes his head, and starts again. Life has shown me I am more suited to the ways of Whale. The furious hunt for knowledge often outpaces the journey to real understanding. Druids are known for changing into animals. What sort of creatures can you become? He takes a half step backward as you ask the question. All sorts of things, he says quietly with a long, uncomfortable gaze. Okay. Hiravias stares at you blankly, arms folded. Let's discuss something else. I use perception. That's an unusually terse response from you. What are you holding back?
It's a long story, and I haven't really told it before to an outsider, so bear with me.
Hiravias shifts his weight from one leg to the next.
I struggled with spirit shifting, the final rite of passage in my druidic training. I prayed to Galloween for insight and, in the style of seekers of old, went to the forest, alone, to ask for guidance. Then I got my answer, an answer at least, in the form of a vibrantly colored Stelgar that pounced from the underbrush and made a salient demonstration of its capacity to eat things 1/15 its size.
Well, you're obviously alive today, so how'd you fend off the beast?
Fend it off? I ripped off its arm and sent it running.
He strikes the face of an offended man, but smiles too wide to hide his amusement.
As the beast was lopping off bits of my handsomeness, I remember trying to fight back, swinging with arms too short to reach. I felt I had the energy for one last swipe at the beast's nose, and when I lashed out with a punch, my arm felt twice as massive, and my fingers sprouted talons! In a rush of power, I shifted into a mirror of my assailant. Apparently, he couldn't pick on someone his own size. By the battle's end, his severed arm was in my maw. The beast limped away in defeat.
That's quite an impressive tale. I thought learning to spirit shift would win me some respect. Maybe trap myself in a Deerin lass with a lust for little men. Alas, I might have been better off staying a novice. When I wandered back to my village, they saw my wounds and asked what happened. I showed them. The name they called my form was the Autumn Stelgar, and... His mouth opens, but he hesitates for a long moment before choosing his words. They were not impressed. The Riau of my circle believed the Autumn Stelgar to be a heinous abomination. It is said that if it eats you, your soul is invariably lost. As this was my first and most intuitive form, they deemed me a carrier of its evil. Even though I never so much as threatened my kin, I was ruled unfit and cast out. Hiravias sighs, scratching his scarred face. I don't know what message Galloween was trying to send. The only lesson I learned was that the Seeker God will punish you for seeking. So you're some sort of soul cannibal? Hiravias stares at you with a frown before covering his face in his hands. No, he mutters. At least I think not. I've never actually sat down and eaten an entire person to find out. I'm not that curious to find out. You didn't choose your spirit-shifting form? No, he says with a huff. It chose me, or so I imagine. I always assumed I would shift into a stoat. Seems more true to my nature. He points to the embossed pattern of whale on his eye patch. As the Obscured teaches, when the answer is inscrutable, one must be content to ponder the question. Were you at least recognized as a proper druid? His brow furrows. No, but I know I passed an initiation rite 5 times more perilous than any of those keen betrayers that insisted I was a failure. Can you learn to spirit shift into something less terrifying? Already can, and sometimes do, he says with a beaming smile that quickly returns to a scowl. But the druids of my circle assign great meaning to one's first form. I'll always be unclean to them. Thank you for sharing your story.
Well, if you don't know me, you can't trust me. And if you can't trust me, odds are low you'll leap in front of a flying arrow to save my life. I've been meaning to visit the druids of Twin Elms to see if they know more about my spirit shift. If our journey takes us there, perhaps they can enlighten me with more information about the Autumn Stelgar. But for now, maybe we can talk about something less depressing?
I want to hear more about Galloween and Whale. He stares at you blankly with his one eye. Oh, not sure what more is to say on the subject, unless you are itching for a religious debate. Okay, my disc ran out of space. So let's continue talking to him.
Need something? May I have a moment, my watcher friend? I'm excited we'll be going to Twin Elms. Nervous, but excited.
Without waiting for your reply, he rubs his hands together and steps in close, lowering his voice. I wanted to ask him more about Whale and... Galloween. Why the mixed feelings?
It's, a matter of, trepidation, maybe. I was never a well-accepted member of my own circle, and I'm fairly certain I'll find some way to make an insult or give offense. And for all I know, the druids of Twin Elms are in contact with the Hawk and Ivy Circle. The Fisher Crane tribe isn't often this far northwest of the bog, but word of my ostracism could have spread. I've spent years coming up with new reasons to put it off. About time I go there and see what Wal wills me to see.
Okay, it's Wal.
Need something? My second favorite subject. What would you like to know?
Right, we were on this. I want to hear more about Galloween and Wal. All right, so I read this. Tell me more about your thoughts on Wal. I came to know Wal in earnest in the first year of my exile. I asked myself why Galloween would punish me for asking questions. What just and fair god would punish me for doing as he asks? Questioning why I had been mauled just drove me mad. At the height of my worry, I would have dreams where I only saw with my injured eye. My healthy eye became blind in my dreams. He lifts up the eye patch to gently itch at the socket. You catch a quick glimpse of a puckered and scarred abscess under the wall-embroidered patch. So, one afternoon I stitched a stylized eye motif on the patch. I like to think of it as my self-initiation rite into the Brotherhood of Wal. Wal is not an instructive or overbearing deity. He does not freely dispense wisdom and expects all of us to question and explore with our own minds. Wal reminds me that curiosity is being receptive to any and all truths, not hunting for any one answer. Has Wal ever actually spoken directly to you, or sent you a sign? No, never directly, he says with a smile, which is as it should be, given what he represents. I especially like how Wal never sends wild beasts to maul me, but maybe I have low expectations of such things. Can't even go back into Wall. What more can you tell me about Galloween? A frown overcomes his face as he ponders your question. Consider it a lapsed devotion. I will always respect the Seeker God. But he visited ruination on me when all I sought was knowledge, just as he taught it should be. He meshes his fingers together and flexes his digits until the joints pop and click. Galloway left his mark on me. When I see my shifted reflection, I'm reminded of his presence. Galloway still inspires my fear, just not my worship. If a god gave me a task and then crippled me for following instruction, I'd be as angry as you are. Yeah? He smiles as his face turns flush. Well, I was an angry wreck when the Riao exiled me. I'm just thankful for the solitude of the wilderness and the wisdom of Wall. Without them, I'd never have come to terms with my situation. Hiravias shrugs your loss. I'm not done talking to him, though. I wanted to ask him about Ir Glanfath, and there might be something else.
Yeah? Need something?
Right, yeah, these two. Tell me about Ir Glanfath. It's a verdant land of history, culture, and natural beauty. His voice falls into a half-whisper as he adds, and we already have enough unwanted trespassers, so I recommend you never visit. Why should I avoid Ir Glanfath? He looks at you, puzzled. There are no cities to visit, no centers of commerce to explore. It would seem most visitors come to our lands to pillage the Ingwithin ruins. The ancient Ingwithins gave the forest to our ancestors, and in return, we watch their ruins and see to it that they remain untouched. And before you ask, no, we don't have a secret passphrase or hand gesture. Nobody enters the ruins, not even the guardians and watchers. Do you miss it? Used to, he says with a slight frown. He scratches his shredded ear and looks eastward. It's home. I'll go back, eventually, but... He turns his attention to his shoulder and picks a small seed from the fibers of his tunic. See this? He holds up the seed. I know, just a seed, but I've never seen this type before, and I'm itching to find out what grows from it. Every day I see something new out here. I'll return home eventually, but for now my curiosity exceeds my nostalgia sevenfold. What can you tell me of your tribe? I'm from the Fisher Crane tribe. Most of my people live far to the south, east and in around the Thane Bog. He weaves his fingers together and cracks his joints in a flexing motion of wet snaps. The tribe is not one of great renown, but we... Hiravias pauses for a moment. They protect their lands in accordance with the sacred oath of old, and as much as it pains me to say it, I wouldn't want any other tribe's name attached to my own. Why aren't the Fisher Cranes well regarded? Because the other tribes are insufferable sibling spawn? He grins broadly and stares at you for several silent moments. I suppose the Fisher Cranes have a reputation for being passive and reluctant to fight, which is another way of saying the other tribes fight hard while we fight smart. Our namesake, the Fisher Crane, is a marshland raptor that remains stark still from sunrise to noon. We are invisible stewards of the land and patient hunters of those who trespass. The three-tusked Stelgar see our methods as soft and unbecoming, but I hear they use the same word for cousin as they do for whore in their dialect. Just an observation. Could you join a different tribe? Hiravias frowns and shakes his head. There are tribes that would take me. The twice-split arrows adopt outcasts like myself, but their ways are not my own. Some of them even live under roofs. How obtuse! He looks off to the southeast and sighs. I long for home, not just any home. But Wall has made my wanderings fruitful, and I accept that it may not be until my soul passes that I rejoin the Fisher Greens. Did you grow up in a bog? Only briefly. Here, let me show you something. Don't commit any of it to memory, please. Hiravias rolls up his sleeves and shows you his forearms. The soft brown fur of his arms is lined with faint stains of henna and scar tissue. This is where I grew up, on the migration trail. I had it marked on my arms during my training. While much of the tribe guards the Thane Bog year-round, many of us, including the Circle of Hawk and Ivy, honor the oath by patrolling lesser-known ruins scattered throughout the lands. He points at several of the henna crescents on his forearm. We eschew houses, take only what we can carry, and move camp every 2 moons to ensure that all our sacred sites are visited at regular intervals. This nomadic patrol is how my druid circle came to name itself. We circle and protect like hawks, but we only ever perch on the ivy of the ruins, that is, nearby trees, never to enter the builder's lairs. Aren't most Orlans in Ir Glanfath wild?
Wild? Yes, I suppose all of us were a bit wild, as my tribe was migratory and we didn't live in permanent houses. But I understand what you're trying to ask. Yes, a slight plurality of Glanfath and Orlans have forest plumage. Growing up with meadow plumage, I was assumed to be weaker than others my age. The huntmaster of my tribe only chose apprentices from the forested kin, or rather, wild Orlans, as they're called amongst slave-owning bigots, as well as bigots too broke to own slaves. I grew up in Ir Glanfath, specifically in and around Thane Bog. My people, the Fisher Crane tribe, are migrant stewards of the land. I've walked the whole of Glanfath many times. What would you like to know?
I hate to have to go out to ask this again.
Need something?
Alright, pull him aside from the group. I'm curious about this. Can we discuss our party members?
Curious about your compatriots? Whom in particular?
Ravia steps in close and speaks quietly. What do you think of Adair?
He's nasty, brutish, and tall. So two-thirds like me, I suppose. The circumference of his neck exceeds the circumference of my torso at its thickest point. They sure do breed them big and dumb in the Deerwood, don't they?
Hey, it's my buddy.
No, I'm being a brat. Truthfully, I think the guy's a lot more gentle than he pretends. He's certainly got a big heart for animals, at least, which is rather telling of who he is under that soldier exterior.
He smiles and scratches film of his teeth as he studies your reaction. What are your thoughts on Palagina?
Her zeal is sincere, and I can tell you she's destined to die on her feet. And she's easy on the eyes. Can't fatten a thoroughbred, that's what I always say. I just wonder if she has a cloaca or not. Ooh, the curiosity is killing me.
Cloaca?
Yeah, cloaca. It's a combination feces chute and happy slot. Huh. Birds usually have these hybrid holes, and I figure she might too. What? Don't look at me like that!
My god, Hiravias.
We can speak another time. Lead the way!
I wasn't done.
I'm ready.
Oh, not you.
Need something?
We were just talking about you, though.
Need something? Curious about your compatriots? Whom in particular?
What do you make of Aeloth?
Oh, him? Him I don't mind too much. Though I could pitch a tent with the pole wedged up his anus. I could smell something funny on him. 2 cents? Not quite. Well, whatever it is, take note of his mood swings. I don't think he's unstable. I just think he has a lot going on up there.
And Sagani? What's your impression?
She actually steps lightly when we travel outdoors, which is more than I could say for the rest of you. They do things differently where she's from. But she knows her way around the woods almost as well as I do. Almost.
Any thoughts on Kana?
Oh, I think I could fit 3 of me, plus a remainder of a 4th Hiravias inside that giant. Gods, am I glad he's friendly. And between you and me, he has a better singing voice than the prettiest lasses I know from my tribe. It's 1 part unsettling, 2 parts arousing. And it makes me wish I still had both ears.
Thoughts on the grieving mother?
Who? Oh, right. The peasant woman that's been traveling with us?
Your question elicits a face of sincere confusion for several seconds.
I guess I haven't kept a close eye on her. Not sure what to say. She seems harmless enough, but she must be a glutton for trouble if she's traveling with us. She'd probably be safer on her own.
Now tell me your thoughts on Durance.
Oh, love at first sight. It's like WoW carved an ever-changing gash in his brain, and every hour he's a different flavor of angry. Durance makes me feel like I'm the same one. He smells like fear in the mornings and rage in the afternoons. I'm keeping my eye on him. He's a laugh, but he might someday be a problem.
Awesome. That's all for now.
We can speak another time. Lead the way.
Nod. All right.
May WoW watch your step.
All right, so next episode. We're finally going to start heading towards Twin Elms. Not completely sure. Maybe we get there from Deerford Crossing. Thanks for watching. See you next time. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.